So far, we were looking at gravitational instability of an infinitely extended isothermal medium. We will now look in the second part at other kinds of instabilities. We will first look at the so-called Toomer instability, which is similar to the Jeans instability, with the difference that we are not looking at an infinitely extended three-dimensional volume, but we are looking at a rotating disk of gas and study the conditions under which this disk becomes unstable. So we have a disk with a finite thickness, and this disk is rotating at an angular frequency omega at a certain radius. So looking from the top at the disk, we have here the radius of a given volume element at this disk, and this is rotating at a velocity omega. Now we assume here that this is not a solid body, but it is a disk of gas. So we might have differential rotation, which means we have different angular frequencies at different radii. So when we look at this volume element a little bit in zoom here, then we might have the case that this part here has a somewhat higher omega than the inner one. And as a consequence, when we look here at the coordinate frame that is centered at the velocity here in the center of the two, what we have is that the one edge is moving in this direction while the other one is relatively moving in this direction. So this is here in the transferred frame, so to speak. And this has an interesting effect, namely that when you have this volume and you take one edge and move it in one direction and the other in the opposite direction, what you basically have is a rotation. You have a shear and you might have rotation due to the transformation here. And this can be described with the so-called epicyclic frequency kappa, which is given as 2 times omega over r times the derivative with respect to the radius of r squared omega, where we have at a distance r from the center, as a consequence of omega as a function of r, an epicyclic rotation of kappa at the frequency kappa. The disk has a so-called surface density, which is just the density times the thickness, and is called sigma. So this is a different sigma from this one here. This is the surface density, so basically adding up all the particles here in this direction. So to describe this, we need to convert our Navier-Stokes equation into a co-rotating frame And then we will have the corresponding centrifugal terms, F centrifugal, which is given by O omega squared R squared. And we will have the Coriolis contribution, which is given as minus 2 rho times omega cross the velocity. So when you insert this ansatz that we did in the genes analysis, the wave ansatz, into our system of equations, then you get to a very complicated dispersion relation, and at the end you can get a stability criterion, which is called the Toomer parameter, after the author who first presented this. And this is given by the ratio of kappa times CS, the sound speed, over pi G times the surface density sigma. And when we have a Q that is smaller than 1, so when we have the case that the denominator here dominates over the numerator, then we will have a gravitational instability, and our disk will consequently fragment and then form, for example, spiral arms. As seen here on the figure on the right hand side of a spiral galaxy. So we have differential rotation, we have a certain surface density, and we have gravitational instability, small perturbations in our rotating disk grow because we have more material, for example, here. So the gravitational pull in this direction is stronger and will pull material from the interarm regions to the gravitational, to the spiral arms here, for example. Of course, these are moving configurations, so we have spiral waves traveling through the medium. We will, in addition, have an asymmetry of the gravitational force, because material will feel stronger attraction along the gravitational arms. So we will have material inflowing along the spiral arms towards the center of the gravity, as long as it's able to get rid of angular momentum, which will carry some material to larger radii. And this instability in our disks, these Toomer instabilities, form basically then giant molecular clouds in a galaxy, but they also act on smaller scales because we also find rotating disks of gas in the formation of stars, so protoplanetary disks, and in these disks, these instabilities lead to the formation of planets. But the physics is exactly the same. Let's now take a look at a different instability that comes from layering two faces of the material on top of each other. This is called Rayleigh-Taylor instability. We take the hydrodynamic equation. We have a gravitational field that is dominated by the external gravitational potential, so not created here by our material itself. And so the gravitational force is, of course, given by this. And what we have is we have two layers of their gas with different densities, rho 1 and rho 2. So rho 1 is the one, the rho 2 is the one on top, and rho 1 is the one on the bottom. We have different sizes here of this layer. The material is at rest, and we are looking at this in a simple two-dimensional description. So we have here just the x-coordinate, and we have then the z-coordinate in on the y-axis here. And again, as an ansatz for our perturbations, we introduce a superposition of waves such that we introduce a perturbation here of delta C as a function of x and time. So a standard wave here with some amplitude times the exponential of I and then kx minus omega t, now in scalar form, because we are looking only here at this scalar form. And when we put this ansatz into our system of equations, given our assumptions, we find the following dispersion relation. We have in the numerator k times the gravitational acceleration, and then rho 1 minus rho 2. And this is divided by the denominator rho 1 times the cotangens hyperbolicus of k h1 plus rho 2 times the cotangens hyperbolicus kh1. And when we go back, h1 and h2 is exactly here the size of our two layers. This is h1 and this should be h2. So the cotangens hyperbolicus can also be written as a combination of exponentials. So ex plus e to the minus x divided by the difference between the two. And this can be also written like this. And this behavior, and when we plot this, it looks like this, approaching the limit of 1 for large arguments. And the negative is the inverse case here. We only need to look at positive numbers because this will be, the argument will always be positive. And we saw from the previous analysis that for an instability, we need a negative omega squared. So a complex omega, and the denominator will always be a positive number. Yeah, the cotangens hyperbolicus will always be something larger than 1. The densities are positive numbers, and the two factors are added, so this will always be positive. So for our dispersion relation to become negative, we need rho 1 to be smaller than rho 2. So in our example here, we need the dense material the high density on top of the low density material. And from our general physical understanding, we always expect gravity to order fluids, but also order particles with higher densities to be arranged as low as possible to minimize the gravitational potential in a stable configuration. So once we have a heavy medium on top of a light medium, what we have is a Rayleigh instability, and this is called inversion instability. So once we have this case here, that we have a small perturbation and we have a small volume of our material being arranged somewhat lower than it used to be before, the overall energy is somewhat lower, and the system can get to a more stable solution by lowering the energy even further, and this happens by bringing the material down here. So this inversion stability tries to turn over the configuration to have the dense material on the bottom and the heavy on top. And as an effect, this instability produces structure at our boundary. On the right hand side, on the bottom, you have here numerical simulations of how this boundary here behaves over time. And you see that with time, this grows here in this direction and moves further down. But as an addition, what you have is when you look at one volume element here, basically an introduction of a torque, because the right hand side of the box is accelerating faster downwards than the left hand side box. So you introduce kind of a curl here, a vorticity that starts to form here these eddies, and this forms this caps here, because the material is not just traveling downwards but bending outside because of the vorticity that has been introduced. So what we see here is the formation of turbulence at the boundary. On the top you see this as an experiment where you have some corn syrup here on top of water, and then you form these droplets with the tail here, and this is also observed in the interstellar medium. We have these mushroom caps by these expanding waves, and we see this in the interstellar medium where we have on the outside basically a dense material and we have the thin material in the inside, but the gravitational pull is going in this direction, and we form these clumps and the condensations at the boundary between the dense and the thin material. It's also instructive to take the dispersion relation of these two stratified media and look at stable solutions instead. The first is the so-called deep water solution. Imagine a fluid of very low density on top of something that is very high density. So we have, for example, air on water, so that the lower density medium is on top of the high density medium. As a consequence, let's change colors here. As a consequence, density 1 minus density 2 is approximately density 1. And we assume that the width of our atmosphere and of our water layer are much larger compared to the wavelengths of the perturbations that we look at, so that the product k times the H1 or the H2 are much larger than 1, and as a consequence, the cotangens hyperbolicus of this argument approach 1. We saw this on the previous slide. So this simplifies our dispersion relation here significantly to omega squared just being k half times gravitational acceleration. This is a nonlinear relation between omega and k, so it's automatically dispersive. When we look at the phase velocity omega over k, which is given as the square root of g over 2k, and compare this with the group velocity, which was the derivative of omega with respect to k, the omega over dk, which is 1/2 of this factor, square root of g over 2k. So when we start by having a wave group, for example, by dropping a stone here in the center and producing a large perturbation as a superposition of many individual waves of different wavelengths, then we have the individual waves moving with different phase velocities. We have these gravitational waves here on the surface, but we see that far away from our perturbation, the medium is generally at rest because they disperse out into smaller and smaller and smaller contributions so that you don't notify anything when you are very far away. Another special solution is the shallow water solution, because in the deep water solution, any disturbance is canceling out after a certain distance. But when we have a very shallow water, so anything remains the same as before. We have again the thin medium on top of the heavy medium so that we can ignore O2. We have a lot of thin medium so that the cotangens hyperbolicus of k times H2 is about 1. But we have now shallow water, so that the argument of the cotangens hyperbolicus kH1 is approximately 1 over kH1. And this gives the following dispersion relation. Omega squared is k squared times g times H1, which now has a linear behavior, omega squared equals k squared. Taking the square root on either side gives a linear dependence between omega and k, which means omega divided by k is the same as the partial derivative. So the group and the phase velocity is the same. Which means when we introduce a large disturbance, a large wave group into our medium, it travels intact over very far distances. And this is, for example, the case when we have a tsunami or some solitons in a solid body. The next instability that we are introducing is the so-called Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. It has a similar configuration to the Rayleigh-Taylor. We have two media separated from each other, but we now ignore gravity, but we assume that they are moving with respect to each other. So we have here O2 and we have here O1, and we assume that O, the medium on top, is moving with a certain velocity. Again, the width of the layers is assumed to be very large here, And from our understanding of the Bernoulli forces, for example, when they travel around a certain wing profile here, we know that when the flow is bent, this introduces a certain pressure in the direction of the bending of the stream lines. Now, analog to this behavior, assume that we introduce a perturbation of here the layer boundary, then as a consequence, the material on top has to move like this. And this introduces pressure forces trying to make these perturbations larger, so they automatically grow. The dispersion relation can be given as omega equals k times the velocity times rho 1 plus minus I square root of rho 1 times rho 2 divided by the sum of the two. So here we will always have this imaginary part. So we will always have a growing perturbation. And here on these four figures, we see numerical simulation of this medium here on top moving in this direction, done for different Reynolds numbers. So what we have is, due to this dispersion relation, that our spatial waves here grow in time, while the temporal waves grow in space. And this is always unstable, and the Reynolds number gives us an indication on how strong this grow can be in our medium. The higher the Reynolds number, the larger these instabilities occur, because when you form such a structure here, the material goes here, then we have a pressure acting, for example, in this direction, so it tries to bend over, and the flow here produces then pressure in this direction, and you have this spiral structures that form these eddies given a sufficiently large Reynolds number. And the interesting thing here is that this also occurs when we look at a medium where the two densities are about the same. So when we have an atmosphere and some shear within this atmosphere, even if the densities are about the same in different layers, this Kelvin-Helmholtz instabilities are formed with this dispersion relation, which simplifies in the case of equal densities to k V half of 1 plus minus I. So even in the case of same densities, we will have these growing configurations. And this is seen sometimes in the atmosphere here, where due to the low pressure that occurs at the boundary of these eddy structures, we have suddenly condensation of water setting in, visualizing the flow profile of our atmosphere layers due to the shear of the material in the atmosphere. This is also, of course, observed, for example, here in the atmosphere, for example, of Jupiter, where you have a differential rotation. So you have layers here moving with different speeds with respect to each other, and this automatically produces these Kelvin-Helmholtz patterns in the atmosphere. Now, if this happens all the time, why don't all waves on the ocean grow exponentially? Because here we have the wind in the atmosphere on top of the ocean blowing always faster than the ocean is actually moving. And why doesn't this lead to exponentially growing wave heights and patterns? And the reason is that once we add gravity, this stabilizes, because the Kelvin-Helmholtz trying to increase this pattern is now also combined with gravity trying to pull the waves back, and this limits the wave sizes. This can be described by the so-called Richardson number, which is the ratio between the potential and the kinematic energy, given by the ratio of G over rho times dP over dC. So the density is d rho over dC, so the strength of the gravitation, divided by dV over dC squared. And dC is basically the height of our perturbation, and this is only unstable if the Richardson number is smaller than 1/4. So we see from the equation that when we have large density gradients, that this automatically stabilizes our system. When we have large velocity gradients, this destabilizes. So stormy sea, storm winds produce high waves, while calm conditions and high density gradients stabilizes the system. As a last instability, we want to look at the Parker instability, that is again now looking at a disk. So again, we have here our disk shown from the side and from the top, and we have here the special configuration that in our disk we have magnetic field lines that rotate with the disk, and they are given here in this figure with the white lines, and we have a coupling, as we saw in the previous lecture, of the particles to the field lines, because our medium is partially charged. So due to the differential rotation and the layering of the disk, so we have lower density here compared to here, we will have Rayleigh-Taylor instabilities, and we will have Kelvin-Helmholtz instabilities that produce perturbations of our material on the surface. So we will have waves forming on the surface of the disk, and since our magnetic field lines are coupled to that, they are distorted and add a magnetic pressure now to the system, and we form then over time here these these magnetic field lines that thread basically in and out of the system, and this is called Parker instability. which means we have on the surface, for example, also regions where we have field lines of opposite direction entering and leaving the material. This is, for example, what happens on the surface of the sun with sunspots. So in the section on our instabilities, we saw how, given certain circumstances, instabilities arise, and these instabilities form certain structures, and this hierarchical structure formation is basically what we call turbulence, because a large structure produces somewhat smaller structures, produces hierarchically smaller and smaller substructures in a self-similar fashion. And this can be modeled under certain circumstances, but to compare it with observations is of course necessary to look at statistical measures, because the occurrence depends on some initial fluctuations, perturbations in our medium, which are unobservable and randomly distributed, of course.